Good morning. And welcome to Oakview Baptist Church. So delighted that you're here. We're going to come into His presence with singing and into His courts with praise. Let's stand as we worship together from our hearts.
To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. Great things He has taught us, great things He has done, and great rejoicing through Jesus the Son. The purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done.
I have found a friend in Jesus, He's everything to me. He's the fairest that can go into my soul. The lily of the valley, in Him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow He's my comfort, in trouble He's my stay. He tells me every care on Him to roll. Hallelujah! He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest top 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken, and all my sorrows gone. In temptation is my strong and mighty time. I have all for Him forsaken, and all my time is gone. From my heart and now He keeps me by His power. Oh, all I forsake now, and Satan tempts me sore. Through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. Hallelujah, He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by taking to His blessed will. Oh, all afar above me, I've nothing now to fear. With His manna He my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see His blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest captain thousand to my soul. floods my soul. Something happened, and now I'm here. He touched me and made me whole.
You may be seated as we give our attention to the baptism.
Amen. What a joy it is to see you this morning. Good morning to you. Amen. I want to introduce to you Mary Garcia. Many of you know Mary. Come on down. Mary is coming today, a longtime believer and follower of Christ, but now to follow the Lord in a believer's baptism. And Mary, have you trusted the Lord as your Savior and Lord of your life?
Yes.
Amen. She has a wonderful testimony of that through the years. Been a part of our family, Oakview family here now for, gosh, a long time. But now comes to say, I want to take a stand for Christ in baptism, follow him in that obedience. So you pray for Mary in the days ahead. In obedience to the divine command of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and upon your public profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my sister Mary, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in a brand new life. Amen. Amen. Bless you.
Amen. What a wonderful opportunity. And I think we're going to have four or five baptisms in the next service. So God is moving in a mighty way in the life of our church, and we're so thankful for that. So we are glad that you're here, that you have joined us, and welcome again. So raise your right hand, everybody raise your right hand, and just kind of wave around, catch everybody. Everybody catch those vibes. Those of you who are online, I'm waving. We are glad that you've joined us for worship also. So we're just recognizing that the crowd that we have right now on campus, and to recognize that there's probably as many as this number watching online for worship today. So we're very, very thankful for that. Have you had a good week? Has God been good to you? All right. Have people been good to you? No, never mind. Don't go there. God's always good, isn't he? All the time. Hey, I want to tell you about our drive-through fall festival. Drive-through. Now, it's not a speed track through the parking lot, but in your bulletin, you see a sign up, a way that you can participate, and we need everybody's help on that night. We ain't never done it this way, so why not? Why not, right? The drive-through fall festival, it's going to be a great opportunity of outreach to our community. Those of you online who are interested in helping, call the church office, and we'll get you signed up to help out for that evening. And we need lots of candy. Of course we need lots of candy. So you can bring that candy to my office where I am candy control person. Just easy. Just want you to know that. So bring that candy, and we appreciate it. The kids will love it. We're going to have a great time on that Wednesday night, October the 28th. Also, let me share with you that out here in the Commons area, to your right, on the north end of the Commons, there's a display called Home View. There are books you can purchase. There are books that are free. There's lots of different material for family and ministry. So you take advantage of that. Go by Home View. Pick up those pamphlets that are helpful to you or may be helpful to a family member. And let me tell you that if you'll go to ovbc.net, on the homepage, you'll find it's called My Family Season. My Family Season. And you can click on My Family Season, and there's all kinds of resources available in regards to family. Very much, it really complements our home view. So make sure you go by home view, pick up some of those resources. Use that as an outreach to friends and those around you. Now, you know that we are sponsoring the Nimitz football players. We are adopting those players, and many of you have already signed up and begun to do that, provide a bag each week of goodies that we support and encourage those players during their season. Well, we have about six players that still need a sponsor. So if you are interested in being a sponsor, or if you want to add somebody to somebody you're already helping, you can talk to Randy or Linda Randall and or Jack Teal, and you can sign up for that other sponsor, so be a sponsor for one of those players. So take advantage of that. It's a great outreach. We've done that for a number of years, and we've been reaching a number of those students for Christ through that opportunity. So we are glad that you're here. We want to continue to worship. So let's pray together. Father, we just come before your presence, very thankful for the week that you've provided us, the opportunities, the outreach, the opportunity to be your witness. Today, we come together as believers, as brothers and sisters in Christ, as your children, to raise our voices in song and to open our hearts to the challenge of your word. May we do all things to give you honor and glory this day. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, and all God's people say, amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we continue to worship. Let's proclaim together.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
Name above all names. all names. Name above all names. Worthy of all praise. My heart will sing my praise of God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Be seated.
Thank you, worship team. Well, baptism has been an excellent reminder of the rebirth that I've had, and I know that many of you have experienced as well. Mine was in June of 1972. I grew up in the Baptist church. So if you cut me open, I may bleed a little bit of Baptist, but I hope I bleed Jesus more, if you know what I mean. And this song, anyway, is a reminder of the marvelous change that God brings at rebirth. But aren't we grateful he also works on us before rebirth? He draws us to himself even before and afterwards. Have probably most of us have sinned once or twice since rebirth. Probably, yeah. We still have a little old nature that we contend with, right? But thankfully, through Jesus Christ, there is victory even over the flesh and Satan. There's ultimate victory when we see him face to face. And in a moment, totally transformed into his image.
There are some people who say they cannot tell whether we are saved or whether all is well. They say we only can hope and trust that it is so, but I was there when it happened, and I guess I hardly know. Yes, I know when Jesus saved me, the very moment he forgave me, he took away my heavy burden. Lord, he gave me peace within. Satan can't make me doubt it. It's real and I'm gonna shout it, cause I was there when it happened, and I guess I hardly know.
Yeah.
And I don't care who tells me salvation is not real, though the world may argue that I cannot. My heavy burden's lifted and the vile sins go. But I was there when it happened, and I guess I hardly know. Yes, I know when Jesus saved me, the very moment he forgave me, he took away my heavy burden. Lord, he gave me peace within. Satan can't make me doubt it. It's real and I'm gonna shout it, cause I was there when it happened, and I guess I hardly know. Yes, I know when Jesus saved me, the very moment he forgave me, he took away my heavy burdens. Lord, he gave me peace within. Satan can't make me doubt it. It's real and I'm gonna shout it, cause I was there when it happened, and I guess I ought to know.
You've got your Bibles. If you'll turn with me to Luke chapter 21, we're going to get there in just a moment. Appreciate the fact that you're here today. Excited to see everybody. And wasn't that great seeing Mary get baptized today? Amen. I know we got a whole section here that came and cheering for her. Let's give God a big hand for that. Amen. We'll give him the glory. Amen. We are going to be, as Ron, I think, mentioned, we're going to be celebrating, I think, four more baptisms next service, and then we've got a couple more in a couple weeks. So we're going to get caught up. Like a lot of people, we're getting caught up for some things that we would have been doing earlier, so that's exciting. This passage, Luke 21, some of you will recognize as a part of the Olivet Discourse, and that is just all that means is the teaching of Jesus that were done on the Mount of Olives. And so the Mount of Olives is a mountain adjacent to Jerusalem. It is right there, very close. In fact, it was toward the end of Jesus' ministry, as he was heading to Jerusalem and to the cross, that he gave this teaching found in Luke chapter 21. And it is a discourse or a teaching that's about the end times, the future, about what's coming. And it parallels both in Mark chapter 13 and then Matthew chapter 24 and 25. So three of the four Gospels cover the same material that we're going to look at here in just a moment as we kick off this series called Prophecies, Mysteries, and Heresies. And if that didn't cover all the bases, I don't know what does. Anything you hear probably about the future is going to fall into one of these categories. And so we'll talk about how to sort all that out here. Before we get there, I do want to say a word to you. One of the things that's exciting and encouraging is that as we think about the kind of what's ahead, we have a 70th birthday party for this church coming up. Amen? And that's coming up on November the 1st. If you don't have that date down, I hope you'll put it down in your calendar. I hope you'll mark it down as a very important day. That's the time change Sunday. You'll get an extra hour of sleep. We'll have a wonderful celebration and worship, and then we'll have a old-fashioned sort of dinner on the grounds, and I hope you'll plan to be here for that. It's going to be a great day, and just thanking God for what he's done, and he's not through with his church. I think this just getting started here at Oakview, and so I hope you'll be here to see both a Thanksgiving time as well as a vision time of what God will do and has done and will do in the future. And then just one other word just kind of about just things coming, and Ron may have already hit this, so forgive me if I'm repeating myself him here, but this Wednesday we're going to relaunch our Wednesday night Bible study here on campus, and we'll have it online as well. So we'll have, just like worship, you can tune in online, or you can tune, we've been doing it online, but you can do it have it on campus here in the BEC building from 6 to 6:30. It's a brief time, but a very powerful time. We have prayer together, a Bible study time, and then we'll let others get free to go to choir and other things that will be happening later on in this month. But I invite you to come back this Wednesday for a time of prayer and Bible study. I hope you'll would enjoy that. You know, this is toward the end of his ministry, you know, on the Mount of Olives. You kind of picture this scene. I mean, some of you here have been to the Holy Land. And you know this from pictures I've seen. It's just a beautiful area right there above Jerusalem to the east of the city, the old city of Jerusalem. And Jesus gives this amazing teaching. In fact, this is the same location where he ascended back to heaven. It was from the Mount of Olives in Acts chapter 1 that Luke records that Jesus, after the resurrection, came back to the Mount of Olives and ascended into heaven. But before he went into heaven and before he went to the cross, Jesus wanted to prepare his followers for what's next and what's coming. And so that's what Luke chapter 21 is about. And I would encourage you, as we look through this passage, and you see, and there's so much more we can study from this passage, but I want you to come back and read through and maybe look at the Mark and the Matthew accounts as well. But there's this sense in which Jesus wanted his followers to know that God has this unshakable plan for the church and for individual believers. He wanted them to know that even though he was leaving and going back to heaven, he wasn't leaving them either in the immediate presence alone or in the forever presence when we'll be in his presence. So he wanted to give them this assurance that there was a plan for everything that was going to happen. And if you think about the history of the church over the last 2,000 years, you know there's an amazing number of things that have happened that the church has weathered and survived and come through. And we talked about some of those in the series on the church and what God's plan is for us as believers through this body of Christ that we call the local church. Now, what he's wanting to prepare them for, though, are things that they had yet to, that they've never seen before, things that just never ever happened before. And so he gives these signs, he gives these sort of markers that they can look to that will help them have some bearing when things get different and become strange. And I think if we were to characterize what's going on in our world today, we'd recognize that that's a lot of what's happening today, where there's an uncertainty and unprecedented nature of what's happening in our world. And so, you know, we have to be able to think biblically. And I'll tell you, when you see a newscast or a news story or information given to you or read something on the internet, you have to be able to process it biblically. So that's the reason for this series, because if you think about all the things that you're going to hear, and some of it is true, some of it's not true, some of it's partially true, it will fall into this category if it's about the future. And one is, if it's a prophecy and it's of God, then it will give you direction about what's to come. If it is a mystery, it is going to be something that is so far beyond our ability to understand that no person can fully grasp it. And I constantly hear people talk about mysteries as if they have been the one person that something's been revealed to that for 2,000 years has been a mystery in the church, because God is so much bigger and greater than us, we can't fully explain it, okay? And there's a beauty in mystery. And then there's this third category called heresies. And I want you to be prepared as you think biblically about each day as it happens, some new headline, some new story, some new information, that you understand that some things are just not true, they're false. And we have to know the difference between truth and false, or partial truth and total falsehood. And this is where, as we go into God's word, as Jesus prepares us for those things that we haven't seen before, we begin to understand that these are the things he wants us to understand. He wants us to know, what is it, can we know, what is it we can never know, and what is it that we should never believe because it's not true. And so there's just been this question that has been raised, and if you've been online much, and certainly probably it peaked out in about April of this year, March and April, everybody was asking, and I think people still, it's kind of still percolating in their mind. And there's a question that they're asking, because it's sort of something that naturally, it's a series of questions, but it's come out of this sort of apocalyptic situation that we're in today. In other words, that you can't help but have this feeling that, is there some sense that what's happening, because it's never happened before, that we may be approaching something toward the end of time? And I think this is true of believers and non-believers. They're both asking this question, when is the end and how's it going to come, or when's it going to happen, or how's it going to happen? And so this question continues. And when you see those, in some of those images, we won't ever probably forget, you know, empty streets, empty supermarket shelves, stories and reports about people taken ill, and situations where things have gotten worse than someone ever could imagine. Hospitals that are filled with sick people. Now, even though the curve is flattening, and that's what we were hoping for, there is still this continued sense of uncertainty and unworriedness about what's coming in the future. Here's how I would express the questions. Here's what they're asking. Is there a connection between COVID-19 and the end times? Are we living in the last days before the return of Christ? And is the coronavirus a sign that we are in the end times? I think those are all good questions, and they're ones that are on people's minds. So let me just start by saying this, and if you've got the outline, I hope you'll look at it with me. And that is, first of all, is this. Let's start out by defining what a prophetic sign is in the Bible. A prophetic sign is an event, a place, or a person whose existence indicates something important in God's plan for the future. Now, that's intentionally broad, but that is giving you an idea of what a prophetic sign is. And we can talk more about what a prophet is. And a prophet is someone who receives a word from the Lord that is always true. And so somebody who's 50-50, it's not from God, because a prophet always has a word from the Lord. But a prophetic sign is from God, and it's just an event, place, or a person. And so we'll keep that kind of definition in your mind. Now, what we see in Luke chapter 21 is this list of signs, of prophetic signs of the coming of the end of the age. And then, but at the end of it, so if you'll let me do this, I'm going to start with the last part of the chapter, because there at the end, Jesus gives a parable that's also found in the other two gospels, and it deals with the parable of the fig tree, which is a picture of the kingdom of God. Now, I know people talk about the end times, but what the end times is the beginning of the kingdom of God, which is an amazing thing. It's a wonderful thing. God doesn't give you an end without a beginning, all right? And so the beginning is that the kingdom of God will fully come, and we can talk about the millennial reign of Christ, and then this forever time where we'll be with him forever in this new age, the eternal age in heaven. So, but for right now, what I want you to know is this parable, and he says this, Luke 21, he says, he told them this parable, story, earthly story with a heavenly meaning. Look at the fig tree and all the trees, and when they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know the summer is near. Even so, now keep in mind, this is happens every year, has for 2,000 years, this beginning, and in their case, the fig tree fully bloomed, not in the spring, but in the summer. He said, so even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. There's fruit coming from the fig tree, but the leaves have to sprout first, is basically what the parable says. That's true of every fruit tree. There has to be a blooming, a sprouting of leaves, and in blooms in some cases, and then there's fruit, and the fruit is the kingdom. And so he's saying, this is true of everything that you're going to see. Keep in mind, the signs are not the fact that it's going to happen tomorrow, but rather the signs are giving you this kind of a warning to be ready and to know that God is on the move. He's working. He's got a plan, and his plan is a good plan. Now, in Matthew 24, there's an additional statement, a parable, a picture of the end times. And what he says it very simply. It's in verse 8, Matthew chapter 24. And I'll just read it to you. Just a few words. He says, all these things. He gives a list that we're going to look at here in a moment of end times signs, prophetic signs. He says, all these are the beginning of labor pains. Now, he pictures there, Jesus is saying that the end of the age, my return is like labor leading up to a birth. And I tell you, you know, when Tasha had Matthew, our first, I remember that 22 years ago, you know, it was a very long labor. It was really tough for us. Okay, it was tough for Tasha. Okay, I just sat there and watched. You know, some of your moms are like, you better stop. I couldn't even hold that for very long. It was tough on her, and I had to watch, but it was hours and hours of labor. And here's what happened. As you all know, you start with the labor pain, you go into labor, and you know something's about to happen. And then what happens is the intensity of the pain, or so I'm told, increases, and the repetition of the contractions increase. And so there is increasing intensity and increasing frequency of these labor pains. And so what Jesus says in Matthew 24, the signs that we're going to look at will, toward the end, become more frequent and more intense. Okay? So two pictures. There's plenty of warning. There's plenty of, you know, there's this sprouting of leaves, and then there's the fruit that will come, and there's a season of preparation that gives everybody the opportunity to be ready for Christ's return. The second part is that it will increase, these signs will increase. So what are these signs that will increase in frequency and intensity, okay? And these are found in verse 7 through 11 of chapter 21. And it begins there in verse 7. Let me just read through the passage. It says this, the teacher, his disciples said, because his disciples, they wanted to know just like we do. Disciples said this, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place? They just want to know, you know, Jesus says there's this end time coming. And he says, well, how do we know? How do we know this is going to happen? So I want to list for you six different signs out of Luke chapter 21. There's obviously more than this, but these are some of them. Some of the signs of the end times. First one is this. There will be false teachers and leaders. Okay. Beginning there, verse 8, look what it says there. Watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name claiming I am he. The time is near. And he says this, do not follow them. Do not go after them. Do not listen to their teaching. And so we have to be aware that there will be false teachers. And we can look back now in the last century, and there have been hundreds of false leaders. But the question of the intensity and the frequency. Here's the second question, the second sign. There'll be warfare among the nations. Here's verse 9. He says this. He says, when you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. Now keep in mind, the first command is do not follow false leaders. So you got to know how to know if they're false or not, right? If they follow scripture, they're true. If they don't, they're false. Then you have to be, there's warfare among the nations, which there have been thousands of wars since the time of Christ. So when you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first. Then the end will not come right away. Then he said to them, nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. So that's the second sign he gives. Verse 11 is the third sign that he gives. That's verses 9 and 10. And there's an increase in famines, earthquakes, and plagues. And of course, plagues is the one that is on people's minds right now. Look what it says there in verse 11. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences. That's the word that's translated in our dictionary as, in fact, a pestilence is a series, or pestilences would be a series of fatal epidemic diseases. And there have been lots of those, of course, in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven in verse 11. So there's that third sign there, increase in famines, earthquakes, and plagues. Again, we have seen lots of those. We have seen lots of famines and earthquakes and plagues. There have been lots of lethal plagues, as you know from history. And then the question is, has there been an increased intensity and frequency? Well, remember this, in the 1300s, and many of you that are students of history know this, that in the mid-1300s, there was something called the bubonic plague, and the bubonic plague was also called the Black Death. And in that moment, or in that short span of a couple of years, 200 million people lost their lives. About half the population of Europe was killed out in the middle of the 14th century. And then in 1918, there was an incredible, also intense sort of plague, and it was called the Spanish flu. 40 to 50 million people died in that in 1918. And so we know there have been terrible, awful things that have happened before. And yet we know that in the last just 40 years, there's been a series of increasing sort of animal-based sort of viruses that have come up too. So, you know, we're sorting through this to know that there are things that lead us to think that this intensity seems to be, certainly the frequency seems to be increasing, especially as there becomes be more contact and more options for viruses to take hold between animals and people. So what about COVID-19? Let's just pause here for a moment just before we jump into this message any farther. It's clear that COVID-19 qualifies as a lethal pandemic, certainly an epidemic, but it's a pandemic. And it is a sign that we are living in the last days. I don't doubt that, and I think there's lots of other signs of that. And then you say, well, what are the latter days, and when will that happen? And we'll talk a little bit more about what we can, if that's a mystery or if that's a prophecy that we can know. But believers for hundreds of years have walked through this awareness of seeing these kinds of things happen and knowing Christ could come back anytime. In fact, Paul writes that way. He writes with the expectation that Christ will return in his lifetime, and so do other writers of Scripture. And so there is this admirable and important sense that we ought to be in a position, a place where we're anticipating the return of Christ. That is a characteristic of a believer who's following Christ, is the one that looks forward to his coming, doesn't dread the thought of it, okay? So that's an important thought. But this COVID-19 situation has caused a lot of folks to wonder, you know, what's unique about it? Well, certainly how quickly it spread, the intensity of it is unique. But here's one thing that's unique about it that never has happened before in history, and that is it's occurred when our world is more interconnected than ever before. I mean, this idea that between travel and between the internet, everything sort of is global. Everything happens one place is known everywhere else, and then with the freedom of travel, things can move much quicker. Viruses can do that. And so it is. Here's what I believe about it. It has set the stage for future crises and the way they're going to be handled. If you've thought about this, what has happened in COVID-19? We have never seen government take such widespread control over our lives so quickly, and it set the stage for how future crises are going to be handled. And that's why it's a marker in so many important ways. Does it give a timetable? No, but it does create, there's a new day that has begun in our world, and it's been how this has been handled. It informs how future leaders will gain and keep power. And so keep that in mind. It's a marker. It's something we need to know. Here's the next sign of the times in Luke chapter 21. There will be persecutions of Christ's followers. And again, whether you believe, there's a 7-year tribulation talked about in Scripture, and whether you believe the rapture is going to come where the church is taken out before or after or in the middle of the tribulation, you can be a pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib, you know. I'm sort of pan-trib. It's all going to pan out, you know. But wherever you fall in this, the point is there will be persecution of Christians. It's happening now. It's not that we'll avoid that. There is some of that, persecution of Christ's followers. But therefore, all this, before all this, they will seize you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and put you in prison. And you will be brought before kings and governments and on account of my name. So naming the name of Christ will have a price. And that is an important sign. Here's the next one. Because of that, and not only because of that, there is going to be a falling away of some believers. And you go over to the Matthew passage to pick this up, but sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many, meaning the love for other believers and the love for Christ, will grow cold. One of the signs that when fear sort of takes over, when sin takes over, people will grow cold in their relationship with Christ and their love for other believers. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. Paul says this. Now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last times some will turn away. They'll turn away from the true faith. Now this goes back to false teachers. Some of them are going to follow after those things which are false because they'll be sharing a message that they want to hear or that pleases them or seems good in their own eyes. And so they'll turn away from the true faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that will come from demons. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. So falling away of some believers. Here's the next one. And this, finally, there's a good one, right? We got all these, you know, well, that's this and this and this. Well, what about this one? The last one he talks about is the spread of the gospel around the world. And I'll tell you, there is nothing more encouraging to our hearts, and we have been a part of this. It's in the lifeblood of our church. It's the heartbeat of our church to be a part of the global movement of the gospel around the world. So we support missions and missionaries. We do anything we can to increase and help and support missions around the world. We go on mission trips. We pray for the gospel. And so, of course, we know Matthew 24. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world. A lot of questions about what does it mean to be preached throughout the whole world so that the nations will hear it. And then this really strong statement, and then the end will come. So that's a precursor of that. And so where are we at in that process? Well, before we wouldn't know because, you know, earlier days there wasn't the technology to track it. But here's what we do know right now. Of the 6,000 languages that are spoken in the world, over 4,000 of them have the gospel that has been translated, some part of the gospel or some part of the scripture, usually one of the gospels, translated in their language. And that number is increasing every single day. You know, 10 years ago it was maybe 2,500 and now it's 4,000. And on the current, so how are we going to find then the, you know, throughout the world the gospel is preached? Does that mean physically preached? Or does that mean it's going to be through TV or through the internet? TV is now going in the countries that are closed to the gospel through programming that's picked up on the internet. And so the gospel is being preached in ways it never was before. So this is happening, and it continues to be a passion for many Christian leaders to see the gospel spread throughout the entire world. Six different signs of the times out of Luke chapter 21. Now, here's what the transition now what I want to take is this. Now, we can study the signs and look for how they're being applied and wonder what does this mean in terms of a timetable? How soon is Christ coming again? Here's what Jesus does, though. Jesus wants to turn us away from being focused and intensely looking for sort of the next thing that's going to happen so we'll know. Kind of this hunger to sort of understand timetables and sequence of events so we can be prepared. He wants us to be prepared, but not so much so that we can sort of say, well, this won't happen for a long time, so I don't have to be ready. What he wants us to do is focus on how we should live in light of the fact that we are in the end times. And because however you look at it, we're in the end times, whether it's imminent or whether it's going to be not in our lifetimes, it's still over the whole long haul of human history, things are lining up in a way that put us in this window of years. I don't know if it's years or decades, but I do, or months. I don't know. I just know because the Bible says we won't know the time when he'll come again. But he does know we should be ready for him to come today, okay? Such important. So here's some things about how should believers live during these uncertain times. I mean, what is it we need to be doing? Because if our focus, should be on more knowledge, but it should be on not information, but transformation, okay? So here's the first one is this. Conquering fear through faith. This has just got to be one of the bedrock focuses of our life. Conquering fear through faith. Conquering fear through faith. You've heard me and others preach and teach on this, but it's such an important truth of Scripture, and I don't think we can emphasize it too much because of the fact is, now when I say conquer fear, I don't mean the absence of fear. I don't mean the fact that we won't ever be afraid because we will. I think if one thing that COVID has shown us is that we're all vulnerable to fear. There's clearly, and we're all physically vulnerable, we know that, but we're also vulnerable to a fear that's over or non-productive, non-helpful, beyond caution and reason and science, but it's an irrational fear. And so conquer means to move ahead with life, the church to move ahead in its mission in spite of the thing that would pull us back, which would be fear. And so there's scripture that talks about this, and I'll tell you one of the things that people have battled in this in these last months has been sort of the unknown. They've battled the what if, and they've battled the unexpected. They've battled the thing that might happen or could happen. And so what I find in scripture, and I've read through all these passages, and I see this so often, Jesus was really concerned that we not be afraid for what's coming. He didn't hold back and say, well, you know, I'm going to sugarcoat this to you, but he always wanted to come back and say, I'm going to leave, but don't be afraid. Don't be troubled. Don't give up. Don't, you know, in fact, this is the kind of thing that throughout these passages, he says, fear not. You know, in other words, he knew they were going to face some challenges, but he says, trust me, place your faith in me. I'm greater than anything you're going to face. Don't worry about tomorrow. Keep looking up. That's where your deliverance comes from. I'll never leave you alone. I won't give up on you. I will give you a peace that the world does not know. It's a peace that the world cannot give. It defies explanation. It's not based on anything that is beyond, I mean, it's based on anything except the Holy Spirit residing within you. It can't be explained, but it will allow you to keep moving forward when you would otherwise quit. So look at Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. And here's one of the passages. This is one that's in that one of the verses. Don't be afraid of those who want to kill your body. Now he's talking about persecution here. So that's one of those signs that we talked about earlier. You might could broaden that to say, don't be afraid of those things that can kill your body. Now, it doesn't mean you don't have a healthy respect and you do the things that are important to do and you're wise and you follow the science. And I have a chemistry background. I understand and appreciate the value of science. But he says, don't be afraid to the point where it keeps you paralyzed and keeps you unable to move forward in confidence and faith and keeps you trusting God. They cannot touch your soul, okay? There's nothing. COVID-19 can't touch your soul, amen? Nothing can touch your soul. It's secured in Christ alone. Fear only God who can destroy both body and soul in hell. And he's got a warning there saying that if you don't know Christ, you ought to be afraid of that. Because apart from God and Christ, there is no future. There is no eternal future. And so that's something to be fearful of or at least concerned about because you don't want to spend an eternity separated from him. You know, I found this really important, really interesting there. There was a poll taken by the McLaughlin Group. I don't know if you've heard of that group, but it was commissioned to ask questions of people about what they thought about COVID-19. The question they ask them is this: do you think that COVID-19 is a wake-up call to people to return to God? And here's what's fascinating. 44% of Americans said yes to that question. 44% of people said, yes, I believe that. And they believe that this is God's way of getting people's attention and saying, you know, turn to me, come back to me. I am the source of your strength, your hope. And we'll talk about that here in just a moment. So the first thing is this conquering fear. And so, you know, we want to be a resource for that as a church. The scripture is going to help you with that. Your life group is going to encourage you in that. Your prayer group, you know, I hope you have one or two believers you pray with. Your prayer partner. Pray through your fears, okay? Pray over your fears. Pray that God will move you past your fears. It doesn't mean that you'll never have them. Conquering fear is not, it is, courage is the ability to move past your fear or to keep moving with your fear instead of the absence of fear. That's not what courage is. Courage is moving forward. Here's the second thing, and by the way, I just ask you the question on this first one, you know, how are you doing in this faith versus fear thing? Where are you at in that? And how much are you trusting him? And are you using this? Fear can be a great teacher or a great motivator to deepen our faith. Because it's just like, as I've said before, it's like the warning light on the dash of your car that says, I need to worry and fear is like, you need to trust me more. And you need to give that some attention. Here's the second one, though. You have to be able to expose deceptions, okay? And this isn't for somebody who says, well, I don't know enough about the Bible, or I don't have a lot of background. There is enough in Scripture, in the things you already know, for most of us, that allow you to understand and distinguish between truth and error. So expose deceptions with the truth of God. So God's Word clearly will give you some parameters and guidelines. And as you come and be a part of our worship services, we'll build you up in this. If you are part of your Bible study, you'll be built up on that. If you do some self-study, there's some wonderful books out there about different groups and what they teach, and it helps you understand. And you know, one of the things we did with our kids, and in fact, we were talking to Annalise about this the other day, is when we went on vacation, all those years that you let us go on our family vacations. I always took the kids somewhere weird, okay? We'd go to Christ Scientist to go to their church service. We went to Unity Church. We took them places, and they always look at me like, Dad, why are we doing here, you know? And we'd go to some place that was unlike anything that they had seen or heard before. And then we'd sit down and we'd talk about it at lunch and say, what'd you think about that? What was that all about? Why did they say that? We go to different denominations. We go to different places. And in that instruction time, they begin to understand that there were some deceptions or some things that they didn't think squared up with Scripture. We'd always go back to God's Word. And so we need to develop that same skill in our own lives. And so this exposing of it. So, you know, there's this spiritual metaphor in the Scripture of truth as light. And darkness is this is of course error or lying or that which is wrong. But here's what's fascinating about Scripture. You know, we know light and darkness, and we have truth versus error. We understand that those comparisons. But 2 Corinthians chapter 11 says that Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So there's going to be some truth always mixed in with his error. There's always going to be something about it. And that's what sometimes our discussions at lunch would be, well, you know, that was sure good, and they read those verses, and wasn't that great? And I'd always kind of get back and say, well, what do they say about Christ? You know, is Christ alone enough for salvation? And we talk about that. We talk about what the Bible says. It always comes down to what Christ teaches or what they believe or teach about Christ. And so there is this angel of light sort of being wrapped up, and he doesn't come to us and say, I'm evil. You know, we got a Halloween coming up, and you know, pitchfork and a tail in this kind of cartoon view. He comes as one that will be on our side, that will be compassionate, might even be a leader who has this charisma about him. But the point is, understand, are they biblically sound? Are they Christ-centered, or are they not? 2 Timothy 3:16 says this, and this is, of course, where we go to Scripture. And we understand it says, all Scripture is inspired by God. It's useful for teaching of the faith. Here's what it does. It corrects error. It resets the direction of a man's life or a woman's life and training him or her in good living. So it gives us a direction. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. It gives us direction. It allows us to go in the way we should go. Here's the third one. This is just kind of an inclusive one. Be ready for whenever, okay? Just be ready, not for just whatever, but for whenever. And this is the biggest thing I think about individuals who get caught up in eschatology, end times teachings, is they get so caught up in the when that they're not ready for whenever, okay? And so be ready for whenever Jesus returns. And so that means I live with this immediacy of I keep short accounts. I forgive people when they've, I'll forgive them later. No, you don't. You don't know when Christ is going to return. I'll study the Bible later. No, if you're a believer, you study it now because you need it. We don't put off things because we live in the immediacy of knowing that Christ could come back anytime, and there may be things we don't understand about the signs, and so he'll come in a way that is the right time. And so be assured that he will come at the right time, but be ready for whenever that happens, okay? And I can't say that strong enough, how the importance of that and how that'll change your view about how you deal with these things that are coming up in life. And here's just one more thing about being ready is Matthew 24:44 says this, therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming in an hour when you did not expect. So the ones that feel like they've got it all figured out, you know, the big joke is there was a guy, you know, the book that is on my shelf, in fact I saw one the other day on the shelf of one of our members, and it was Why Jesus is Coming Back in 2009, okay? And it was a sequel to his bestseller, Why Jesus is Coming Back in 2008, okay? And then you just keep writing these books, but you don't know when that's going to happen, but be ready for any moment in that case. Okay, here's the last one, is that we are to witness to the hope that we have in Christ. Witness to the hope we have in Christ. People are hungry for hope. There is this hope kind of crunching and killing that's going on in our world today. And I'll tell you, let me just say, there's a book out called The Power of Bad. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's a fascinating book, and he talks about the fact that bad stuff is powerful, okay, and it gets our attention, and so we watch things that are bad, that are negative, and he talks about that negativity trumps sort of positivity in a sense. It just sort of overrides it, and so we see it on the news, and we see it out there, and so hope is the thing that we need to focus on, not the bad, okay? Now, not to be naive about it, but don't focus on the bad. Bad attracts us. The bad moves us. The bad motivates us. But this power of the bad is why the majority of reporting on the virus is negative, even though there's a lot of good things to report. You know, I've got two kids in college, and one of the things that, you know, I'm of course a current concern, as all parents are, but the truth is that 99.9%, the recovery rate for those who get COVID in that 18 to 22 age group is 99.9%. And I'm not saying that that doesn't mean I don't have concerns, but you don't hear that very much. You just hear the stories, and they're terrible about what happens. But keep in mind, there's this power of bad. It holds us, it moves us, it shapes us, and so it provokes sometimes fears that aren't reasonable, and it diminishes hope. And so here's what Luke 21:13, Jesus says this, "And so you will bear testimony to me in the midst of all that's going on." There'll be believers who will grow stronger in the midst of all this, and some are gonna fall away. And you'll be one of those two categories, and so you'll bear testimony to me, but make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves. For I will give you words and wisdom that no one, or that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. Such a powerful phrase. And then look at Revelation 12:10. The importance of our testimony. They will be defeated. They have defeated him by the blood of the Lamb and by the what? By their testimony. By this personal story of a Christ that saved you and given you hope and changed your life. That's how they defeated the enemy, who is an angel of light, who's deceiving people. They defeated him by the word of their testimony, and says they did not love their own lives so much as they were afraid to die. And they weren't afraid of that. They knew that that forever is much longer than anything in this life. And so the ultimate sign that is going to be of his coming, or the ultimate sign of God, is the resurrection of Jesus that's already occurred. When he rose from the dead, he gave a sign for everyone of all ages that he was the Son of God, the only one able to save us, the only one able with the power to come back, to rise. No other leader, no other religion talks about a risen Savior. This is the ultimate sign. We've already had it. And so that resurrection power now lives inside of us. And so Matthew 12:39, just going to close with this verse, wrap it here. He answered, "A wicked and a generation asked for a sign, but no one will be given except the sign of the prophet Jonah." Remember the sign of the prophet Jonah? Because he said this, "For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth." He said, that is the sign. The only sign you need is that one right there. Because if you know that you are following the resurrected Jesus, you know that if he's powerful enough to raise from the dead and forgive my sin, his plan is going to work out, right? That if I follow him and trust him, he can be trusted. Let me ask you to bow your heads with me. And I'll tell you, a service or a sermon that focuses on the end times, I want to just challenge you with this. If you are a follower of Christ, one of two things is going to happen. Either Christ will come back for you, or you're going to go be taken by him. I mean, he's going to come back for you, or you're going to go to him when you pass from this life. One of two things are going to happen. He's going to come back for you, or you're going to go to be with him. And here's the thing. Either way, the Bible describes believers reigning in this coming kingdom with a new heaven and a new earth, and the fulfillment of what believers have been praying for 2,000 years, that the kingdom will come, and we pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." There will be one day when the kingdom will fully come, and that's going to be a glorious day. And so either way, here's what I want to ask you. Are you looking forward to his return? If you're a believer, are you looking forward to it? Are you anticipating it? Are you expecting it? Are you longing for it? It's a sign, and if you're not, it's a sign that you've got to pray that through. Something's not right. So if you're not anticipating, expecting, and hoping for the return of Christ, and that doesn't mean you don't want to live this life fully now. It doesn't mean you want to make the most of every moment you have, but it also means that you long for one day to be with him forever, because that's the promise he gives every believer. And then one more word I have to say before I pray. If you are without Christ, just as we read earlier in the book of Matthew, there is a fearful thought that you could be separated from God forever at the end of this life, or at the end of this age, whatever comes first. And let me tell you, today is the day of salvation, and there is this signs that are everywhere to give plenty of time for people to turn to God. Signs that people sort of inherently know that stuff's happening. This COVID thing's got people's attention, because so this isn't just normal stuff. Stuff's happening. And then one day they'll say, "Well, I didn't know." And I think the Lord will say, "I gave you sign after sign after sign that time was near." Today is the day of salvation. Turn your life over to him. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the clear instruction of your word and the way you give us, because you love us, you give us warnings. As believers, you give us those things that will pull us closer to his prophecy, not to fascinate us necessarily with what we know, but rather to motivate us to live a life of readiness and a life devoted to following you and to witnessing to others. God, your plan is the best plan. I can't imagine living outside your plan, to be wondering what might happen and not to be a part of what you've got planned for us, Father. So I pray as believers we would anticipate your return, that we would prepare for it, that we'd see the signs and be ready to live in faith in the midst of them, knowing that you'll provide for us what we need. And then, God, I pray for those that are without Christ on the other side looking into this, and I pray you'll help them step across that threshold of faith and trust you and know that you are ready to embrace and to forgive and accept them. Not that they have to change before that happens, but that the change comes after they receive that forgiveness. We just come as we are. Would you help them come as they are to you right now, Father? And this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I wanted to say to you, I hope you'll be here throughout this series. We're going to be jumping into a few other things that I think will be helpful for you in these kind of in the midst of the season of life we're in, and it's a challenging time. I invite you, of course, to come Wednesday night. We're going to follow up on some of this end times material in a very short Bible study, probably 15 minutes or so, but it'll give you some more perspective. And then want to also just invite you, as I think Ron mentioned earlier about the Homeview Center, I hope you'll take a look at that. Maybe not for yourself, but grab a resource for somebody you know. There are resources for single parents and for marriages and for families with kids and grandkids and all the kind of things. There's some display free items in the middle, and then on the right side there's display items, and then on the left side there's things you can purchase. So take a look at that material. That's something we've set up to help the family. God bless you. We'll see you Wednesday, hopefully. Thanks, Gary.
Let's stand as we sing together.
You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands while you go out with joy.
Hey! Would you let the ushers guide you out? God bless you. Have a great week.